Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bloody Ties by Karen Ann Hopkins, narrated by Carly Robbins. Preface. April 8th, Indianapolis. Thick clouds pressed down from the ominous-looking sky. As Ryan Donavan glanced over his shoulder, searching for any sign of movement. He caught a sharp whiff of rain and judged that the storm would hit in a matter of minutes. The alley was dark and eerily quiet, except for the muffled gasps of the man whose face he held pressed against the wet pavement. Another guy was sprawled on the ground a few feet away, already dead. A deep red puddle of blood surrounded the man's ruined head. The man's vacant eyes stared at the off-duty cop, seeming to watch Ryan's every move. A third man was slumped over the steering wheel with an equal amount of blood and brain matter littering his hair. Ryan inhaled a gulp of air and thought quickly. The passenger door of the black SUV was swung wide open, and a duffel bag filled with cash sat brazenly on the front seat. Several cereal boxes riddled the ground next to the vehicle. One had popped open during the scuffle, and some of the light brownish-colored powder had spilled out. It wasn't the best quality of heroin, but it didn't need to be. The sheer number of boxes in the back seat equaled millions of dollars in street sales. The sound of sirens wailing in the distance grew louder. Ryan only had seconds to make up his mind. Sure, he hadn't exactly walked onto the scene by accident. He'd received a tip and followed it through to this moment in time where he found himself in the vacant alley, kneeling beside a dying man. Ryan had watched the drug deal unfold, knew the players, and the danger involved in being there. He wasn't on the clock, and he'd acted alone. Luckily for him, Ryan was a highly accurate shooter and didn't need backup for this insane endeavor. Being in law enforcement for over 10 years, he knew the ins and outs of the criminal activities in his city like the back of his hand. The element of surprise was also in his favor. The drug dealers never saw it coming. They were the soldiers of two nefarious armies that operated not only in the shadows of seedy street corners during the dead of night, but in daylight hours at restaurants, sporting events, schoolyards, and even fancy tree-lined suburbs. Their bosses lived far away in mansions on the west or east coasts, on yachts, or in impregnable compounds across the southern border. And yet here they were, easily making loads of money in small cities and suburban centers across the good old United States of America. No one seemed to care about the people whose lives were destroyed because of this shady underbelly of society. Occasionally, the department made arrests, but those times were dropping single grains of sand into a huge bucket. The drugs kept flowing, and people continued to die. It was a vicious cycle that would never end. Greed and the desire to make an easy buck were alive and well in the Midwest. There would never be a shortage of poor souls wanting to escape from their rotten lives, and they were willing to pay a pretty penny to do so. To say Ryan was disillusioned was putting it mildly. He'd worked the beat for years before he'd finally made detective. The pay sucked, and the disrespect from mostly everyone, except other cops, was aggravating. This was a chance to drastically change his circumstances. If he played his cards right, he might just get away with it. A memory rose up in his mind, making his hand holding the gun tremble a little. Serenity Adams, his former partner, sat next to him in the cruiser as it moved slowly down the crowded street. A bottle flew out of nowhere, striking the windshield. The crack was long and wicked-looking, but the glass didn't break. "Why the fuck are we here?" Ryan's voice cracked. His flushed face stared straight ahead. Serenity sighed loudly. "We're here to help people and protect the innocent. You know that." "Damn it, Serenity! They don't want our help!" Serenity's chuckle was low and short-lived. Oh, they'll want us when someone burglarizes their home or hurts their loved one. Human beings are fickle creatures. We're the only thing holding complete chaos at bay. The day we stop doing our job, we're all done for. As long as we stay good cops, everything will be all right. Ryan shook his head vigorously to clear the vision and muttered, "I'm sorry, Serenity. Sometimes you just can't win. If that's the case, you might as well join the bastards." He slammed the man's face onto the pavement and jumped to his feet. Once his mind was made up, it was easy for Ryan to pull the trigger. The gunshot crack blasted through the alleyway, and the last man alive finally stopped moving. At that very same moment, the sky opened up, and pelting cold rain started to fall. Ryan grabbed the duffel bag and ran. He didn't look back, and he didn't contemplate what he'd just done. Ryan's only thought was that he had to get the hell out of Indy in a damn hurry. He needed a place to chill for a while, somewhere that no one would dream of looking for him. He'd thought through his options in detail that very morning, and he kept coming up with the same question. What better place to hide than an Amish community? 1. Serenity. May 8th. Blood Rock, Indiana. Nancy's diner was busier than usual. It was lunchtime on a Friday, so not really surprising. Nearly every booth and table were full, and the sound of too many lively conversations and the clinking of utensils on dinnerware assailed my senses. I took a slow swig of my cola and leaned back. CJ sat next to me. Her curly brown hair bounced on her shoulders as she enthusiastically talked about her upcoming wedding. I kind of zoned out as she recited all the little details. I wasn't a wedding person. Hell, I'd barely gotten through my own, and that was with my now husband, Daniel, making all the arrangements. A sideways glance, CJ's way, confirmed what I'd first thought when she'd first walked through the diner's doors. She looked more carefree than I'd seen her in ages. It was good she was happy again, but the abrupt turnaround of her fortune, when Joshua Miller had decided to go English to be with her instead of the other way around, wasn't really on my mind at the moment. Elaine Weaver was. My gaze strayed to the brunette sitting across the table from us. Elaine grew up Amish, but you'd never know it by the looks of her now. Not only was she runway model tall and slender, but her head was adorned with a thick mane of dark, long hair that she constantly flipped back. She had high cheekbones and wide-spaced eyes that held an almost dreamy, bedroom quality that men couldn't resist. The fact that she was the town's assistant district attorney and a very smart woman was just icing on her already perfect cake. The way Elaine's gaze drifted my way and narrowed for an instant before returning to CJ let me know that the woman had other things on her mind. I was pretty certain one of those things was a good-looking police officer I'd just hired. The situation was complicated and a bit uncomfortable. My former partner, Ryan Donavan, used to date CJ. They'd been a couple for about 2 years, until he'd majorly screwed up and cheated on her. CJ was about as down-to-earth and reasonable as they came. She'd moved on, and was even friendly with the man who had done her dirty. Now that she was marrying Joshua, there weren't any worries about jealousy or resentment on her part. She'd even given Elaine the green light to pursue her ex, so no one's feelings would be hurt. Still, I wasn't too pleased with Elaine's interest in Ryan. There was more going on than I already knew. Something was definitely up with him, and I just couldn't shake the bad feeling that had come over me from the first day he'd arrived in Blood Rock. I hadn't discussed my reservations with anyone, even Daniel. It was just a gut feeling that something unsavory was on the wind. I really hoped that I was wrong. Things had been fairly quiet in Blood Rock lately, and I was actually enjoying the more mundane tasks of law enforcement. After the last year I'd had, I was happy with the relative break. I might be pretty good at solving crimes, but I'd rather not have any more murders in my town, especially since Daniel and I were talking about starting a family.
What do you think, Serenity?
CJ's voice registered in my distracted mind, and her round face came sharply back into focus. I took another sip of my cola and swallowed.
What was that?
Elaine made a huffing sound.
What is with you today? You've been in another world ever since I sat down.
CJ leaned in closer. Her smile turned into a frown and she lowered her voice.
Is something going on?
Just what I didn't need. Being put on the spot about strange feelings I was having that made no sense whatsoever.
No, not really. It's just been a busy week.
In hopes of deflecting my friend's intense curiosity, I added, I've hired 2 new officers in the past couple of weeks. That's a first in Blood Rock history. Ever since the school shooting, the state has been more open with sharing their budget to help our little town out. It's been a lot of paperwork and virtual meetings to get the funding.
Wait, you hired someone else? I thought Ryan was your only new recruit,
CJ said. She propped her chin on her hand and stared with wide eyes. I was glad she'd finally finished discussing her wedding, but wished she wasn't so laser-focused on me. How much was safe to say?
Yeah, the other newbie is Jerome Wilson. He's young, but with 4 years of criminal science and a history of community service, I think he's a huge asset to the department.
I took a bite of my burger, hardly tasting it. Elaine's brows arched as she tilted her head.
I wasn't aware the county budget allowed for 2 new officers. When did that happen?
The assistant DA was sharp as a tack. It was foolish to think I'd be able to slide the information by her without questions.
The state raised our budget.
A lot has happened in this town over the past year and a half. You can safely say we're on their radar. Elaine's lips pursed.
Are you aware of what's going on in Indianapolis?
My stomach twisted. CJ sat up straighter as she looked between Elaine and me.
What's happening in Indy?
Elaine answered her.
There's been several RICO arrests over the winter. Indianapolis is beginning to clean house.
CJ looked at me with a scrunched, confused face. Organized crime, I said simply, answering her unspoken question.
Wait, you mean like the mafia?
CJ's voice rose. It was funny how she quickly looked around to make sure no one was listening. I nodded once.
It's not just the mafia we're talking about. There are other groups that operate illegal enterprises like gambling, drug and sex trafficking, prostitution, extortion. The list goes on and on. Mobsters are still alive and well in Indy.
I had no idea they were there in the first place.
CJ frowned, all of her earlier cheerfulness gone. Elaine crossed her arms on the table, leaning in.
Oh, the city has quite a dark history in that department. The LaBella family established themselves in the early 1900s as a force to be reckoned with. They had strong connections to other crime families, especially in Chicago. Murder, racketeering, smuggling, and the sex trade were all part of their repertoire.
I sipped my cola and gazed out the window. The sun shined, flowers bloomed, and leafy canopies draped over Main Street from the large oak trees in front of the diner. The fountain in front of the courthouse, which was right across the street, fell so dramatically, I could almost hear the sound of the splashing water. The sidewalk was busy with townspeople going about their daily business. It was the perfect afternoon. So why did I feel so melancholy? The lunchtime conversation definitely wasn't helping my mood.
How come you know so much about this stuff?
CJ asked Elaine. Elaine shrugged a little.
I took an entire class on organized crime in America when I was in law school. It's quite fascinating, really. Think about how much discipline it takes to keep an illegal business running. Sure, there are casualties, but for the most part, these organizations, usually family-based, survive for generations. In many instances, they're run just like a legitimate business, there's a boss, who's basically a general manager, an underboss, and different levels of soldiers. The strict hierarchical structure keeps everyone in line, for the most part, anyway. There's bound to be some internal unrest, and that's where the feds have opportunities to nab the crime family's higher officials. CJ turned to me.
How do they operate in modern society? I watched the Godfather movie, and I can see how they got away with it back then. Nowadays, with social media and the internet, it seems they'd be snitched on easily. Nothing is secret anymore.
One of my favorite movies, Elaine commented. The corner of her mouth lifted when her gaze met mine. Sighing, I tugged my ponytail tighter. Don't be naive, CJ. There's still lots of secrets out there, and people who are motivated to keep them. As far as operations go, the modern mafia and other criminal syndicates, like cartels, facilitate business through smaller groups. They network with motorcycle gangs, inner-city gangs, and even backwoods clans to distribute their products, which these days are mostly heroin and cocaine. Although the sex trade is on the rise. I paused, collecting my thoughts and swallowing the lump that formed in my throat. The two girls that were kidnapped in Poplar Springs ended up with people with ties to the Indianapolis mob. The investigation is still ongoing, but arrests of lower-level players have been made in the case.
If you don't cut off the head, it will never end, Elaine spoke in an unemotional way.
True, I admitted.
I don't see what any of this has to do with Blood Rock, CJ said.
It doesn't. Elaine's smile reminded me of a satisfied cat. Just an observation that it might have been a good time for Ryan Donavan to get out of Indy. I've heard the environment in the city is becoming a bit heated. Too many cops have ties to the mob, and the Justice Department is getting serious about thinning out their ranks. My full attention settled on Elaine. She never ceased to surprise me. Her looks were a distraction that obviously gave her snooping opportunities that most people didn't have. She also had more stealth than I'd given her credit for. She smiled back at me sweetly, and I grunted. Glancing back at CJ's worried face, I tried to assure her everything was fine. No worries. The beauty of living in a small town is that some bad things will never take root here.
Heaven knows. We've already had our share of mayhem in Blood Rock, Elaine said.
I wasn't sure if she was agreeing or arguing with me, but it didn't matter. My gaze went to the front door as Ryan walked in. His sharp eyes searched the diner until he found me. Speak of the devil. I grabbed my purse off the seat and quickly slid out of the booth. I have to go, I rushed out. Seeing CJ's face droop, I added, I'll call you tonight and we can talk more about your wedding plans. Say hi to Joshua and the kids for me. Her expression perked up, but I didn't give her time to respond. Elaine had already looked over her shoulder and spotted Ryan. When she turned back around, her mouth was slanted in a tight smirk. I'll stop by your office before the end of the week to discuss the newest prosecution cases in the county. Elaine nodded, not losing the amused look.
Of course. Say hi to Ryan for me.
I hurried away with my lips pressed together. Elaine Weaver had proven herself a solid ally and friend. But there were times when I wanted to strangle her, and this was one of those moments. As if things weren't complicated enough, having her hovering around in the shadows was not what I needed right now. Stopping at the counter, I caught Nancy's eye. She owned the establishment, and even though she had some age on her, she was still a feisty woman. Without having to ask her, she poured coffee in a to-go cup and then picked out a few brownies from the glass case. After she dropped the desserts into a bag, she handed it to me, along with the coffee.
Another long day?
Nancy asked in a country drawl that I usually love to hear. Today, I hardly noticed. Looking that way, I forced a smile. Thanks. I might see you at dinner time. We'll see how the day unfolds. The redhead's face brightened.
I have your favorite, chicken and dumplings, on special tonight.
My face loosened and I smiled in earnest. My mouth is already watering.
Bring your hunky husband in with you. I haven't seen him all week.
Nancy's brow shot up and her mouth twisted wickedly.
I swear, Serenity, you must keep that man locked up in the bedroom or something.
I chuckled, feeling my cheeks burn as I turned to leave. I don't have to lock him in there. He stays willingly. Nancy's cackling laughter followed me out the door. The usual banter with Nancy had lightened my mood a bit. Now, as I joined Ryan on the steps, sudden apprehension made me stiffen under his intense gaze. I knew those muddy brown eyes too well. He was about to give me bad news. 2. Serenity. Ryan matched my strides as we headed toward my cruiser. Without words, I'd already gathered that he'd walked to the diner from the precinct. What's on your mind? I tried to sound casual. I cast a sideways glance his way. Ryan was as tall as Daniel and just as muscular. But Daniel had a construction and excavating business, and his physique had been created by heavy lifting on the job, while Ryan was a gym freak. He spent most of his free time working out with weights and bodybuilding equipment. The results were the same, but I figured it was a lot more sensible to get a job done while staying fit.
I don't like the new guy,
Ryan said in a low voice. I stopped and stared.
That's not at all what I expected him to say.
You are the new guy. I worked hard to keep a straight face.
Ha! Funny. You know who I'm talking about. Jerome bugs me.
The problem with working with a friend was that they were all too comfortable airing their grievances about everything and anything. I already had the exact same problem with Todd, who I'd known since we were kids. It made being the boss especially difficult. People passed by us, going into and out of the diner. I smiled, saying a quick hello to a woman who made eye contact. I lifted my chin, motioning for Ryan to follow me to my car. When we were finally seated and had some privacy, I said, "Not only is Jerome a good cop, he's also a team player and willing to go the extra mile on every case he's assigned to." I hardened my look. "So, what's the real problem?" Irritation flashed across Ryan's features. His Irish roots always gave him away. The man had a short fuse and a terrible poker face.
"He's a little too by the book. You know what I mean."
Ryan glanced out the window, looking around. He was on edge. Nervous energy puffed off of him like invisible smoke. My insides clenched. Ryan's negative aura was getting to me. Inhaling and then blowing out slowly, I leveled a firm look at Ryan. "Don't let our friendship make you forget that I'm the sheriff in this town. I want everyone to follow the rules, even you." Ryan shook his head, completely dismissing my words and tone.
"That's not what I mean. Come on, you know me better than that."
He ran his fingers through his short brown hair.
"Jerome and I went out on a call this morning. It was a domestic case. A man shoved his wife, and she called 911.
Sounds like a typical case. Did you get the wife to file a report? He laughed a little in a low, agitated voice.
"Oh, yeah. But only after Jerome pressed her to do so."
I tilted my head, trying to picture the scene. The sunshine spilling through the windows was warm and peaceful, lulling my nerves.
"How did you want it to go?"
Ryan sat up straighter, facing me.
"It wasn't cut and dry. The woman had thrown an iron skillet at her husband. The chunk missing out of the drywall was right about where his head would have been."
He snorted, rubbing his chin.
"The couple began fighting over the bills, and it escalated to accusations of infidelity, which, frankly, after talking to both of them, I don't see either one as the cheating type."
I couldn't remain silent. "And what is the cheating type?" Ryan frowned, scratching the side of his neck.
"Hey, this isn't about me and CJ. I might not be the greatest person, but I'm a pretty good judge of character."
I couldn't argue with him about that. In the past, his gut instincts saved us on several occasions and helped us wrap up too many criminal investigations to count. Flicking my hand, I encouraged him to continue.
"Serenity, all they needed was a good talking to, and that's what I did. After about 10 minutes, they were both calm and ready for reconciliation. The woman admitted that she'd gotten carried away and regretted that she'd nearly decapitated her hubby. The man apologized for shoving his wife with the side note that he was simply protecting himself. We could have gone home without any paperwork, and the couple could have gotten back to their dysfunctional relationship. But no. Jerome fucked it up when he got the woman alone and convinced her to file a report.
Sighing, I slumped back. I understood all too well what Ryan was talking about. As cops, our job wasn't just to maintain law and order by making arrests. We spent an awful lot of time counseling people. With little psych training, we often found ourselves in situations where we had to be mediators and psychologists. Some of us were better at it than others. Ryan was a people person. He genuinely liked getting involved and helping people. That was probably his strongest asset. But he was also someone who left too much up to fate and didn't always like following the rules. This personal domestic call was the perfect example of how two law officers might handle a case differently. Whenever any kind of abuse is committed, whether it's spousal or any other relationship, the victim has the right to file charges and should be encouraged to do so. How many times have cops left the scene and found out later that the violence escalated to serious injury or death to the victim? Every violent act must be taken seriously, I warned. From the uptight look on Ryan's face, he was only half buying what I was saying.
True, but this time it was mutual. There's just as much a chance that this woman will do harm to the man as the other way around.
The laws protect everyone. No one said you should be gender biased about violence. I've known some extra scrappy women who've proven to be really dangerous. I took a gulp of my coffee and set it back down in the cup holder. It sounds like Jerome went a different direction when you wanted to go on this one. I shrugged. Didn't it work out all right in the end? Ryan barked out a short grunt of laughter.
If you call the end of an 18-year marriage with four kids still in the house a good ending, then I guess so.
I pressed my fingers to the small throb at the side of my head. What do you want me to do, Ryan? You know how it is. We live in a far from perfect world. You can't control the fact that a couple has serious problems and their argument turned physical. I let out a long breath. As far as I'm concerned, Jerome acted accordingly. They need counseling and supervision, and they'll get it now. Perhaps their marriage can be saved, and if not, I'm sure the family will be better off in the long run. It's terrible for children to be raised in a home where the parents are constantly fighting. As if nothing I said registered at all, Ryan blurted out,
"Why can't we still be partners? We worked great together."
I had been waiting for him to ask, and was ready. I work on my own a lot, and when I need a partner, Todd's my man. I told you that on day one. With your experience, I need you working independently from me. It makes the department better and also takes some of the pressure off of me. It's a sign of my trust in your abilities that I'm willing to give you so much responsibility straight off from your hiring.
I don't like Jerome, and that doesn't make for a good partnership, Ryan said firmly.
Ryan had strong instincts, and he was my friend. That's why this conversation was bothering me so much. I licked my lips. You don't have to like him. Hopefully, over time, your relationship will improve. I hesitated, hating to bring the subject up, but knowing it was the right time. Your precinct captain said you were in on the latest round of RICO arrests, that you told him you wanted out, fearing for your life after the detective work you did on the Moretti family cases. That's when you called me. Captain Turner hated to let you go.
Yeah? What of it?
I was used to Ryan's belligerence. At times, he could be quite the pain in the ass.
Sounds like a lot of heads are rolling in Indy. Do you want to tell me about it?
Ryan suddenly smiled.
Nothing much has changed since you left. Captain Turner is on the up and up, but there's enough in the ranks with direct ties to the Morettis that it made me uncomfortable to stick around. Like I already told you, I was in pretty deep myself with undercover work for a while. The feds are tightening the net around the city, and I didn't want to be there when it blows.
Ryan sounded tired, which was unusual. Everything he said made sense. I'd dealt with some of the politics when I was on the job in Indy. The major difference between us was that I'd been cautious to walk a very straight line, something that Ryan wasn't always so diligent about. He had such an outgoing personality that everyone thought of him as a friend. Friendships with the wrong people could cause complications quickly in the underground world we were supposed to police. I heard there's substantial drugs making its way into the city, and that the cartel is developing a firm base there, maybe even working with the Morettis. I hoped I could keep Ryan talking. He was known to become tight-lipped when he got into uncomfortable territory.
Hell, Serenity, you don't know a fraction of what's going on in Indy.
His eyes locked onto mine. There was warning in those brown depths.
If you love your husband, friends, and this town, it's better if you stay ignorant.
I was about to ask Ryan to clarify what he meant when my phone went off. It was Todd. I quickly read the text. A car had hit a buggy in the Amish settlement. The bishop had requested that I come straight away. My heart rate sped up. Was someone I knew in the buggy? Was anyone hurt or worse? With a racing mind, I started up the engine. The biggest question swirling around in my head was why the bishop would ask for me personally. Accidents sometimes happened in the settlement, and I wasn't usually summoned. With everything else on my plate, I certainly didn't need trouble in the Amish community. I feared that the long stretch of relative peacefulness might have just ended. I glanced at Ryan. His face was expectant, and his posture was ready for action. How would you like to drive out to the Amish settlement with me? There's been an accident, and maybe something else is going on. Ryan flashed a brilliant smile.
Just like the old days. You and me working a case together. You can count me in.
Somehow I didn't think this would be like our past cases, even though our relationship was strained. It was nice to have Ryan sitting next to me once again. 3. Daniel. Father tapped his finger on the passenger window and avoided looking at me. A glance in the rearview mirror and I found the opposite with Ma. She stared directly at me. Clearing my throat, I tried to keep my voice level.
Maybe Zeke's changed. Did you ever consider that?
Father came suddenly alive. With a loud snort, he flashed angry eyes my way.
Ah! The boy has always been a troublemaker. Worse than you. He's tainted by the outside world, and we will not allow him to live among us.
I ignored Father's wrath and glanced again in the rearview mirror at Ma. What do you think Aunt Melinda would say to all of this? He was her only child, even though she died a while ago. I'd like to think she would have welcomed her son back. Ma flicked her hand in the air.
She knew better than the rest of us about Zeke's dark side. She never stopped loving him, but she gave up on the boy many years ago.
Other than Father's annoying tapping, the cab fell into a strained silence. I returned my gaze to the neat farmsteads we passed by as we drove back into the settlement. Taking my parents to the doctor's office was not on my schedule today. The out-of-the-blue call had surprised me, but I'd readily volunteered to make the trip when their regular driver had canceled on them last minute. After Father's heart attack the year before, he had to have regular checkups. Eating healthy and getting a lot of exercise wasn't a problem for the stubborn man, but going into town for a doctor visit was another story altogether. The pleading sound in Ma's voice on the phone call had made me drop everything at the building site, jump into my Jeep, and head to their home. Ma was happy to see me. Father definitely wasn't. He'd thought he'd gotten a pass to miss the appointment, and I'd ruined his good mood by showing up to play chauffeur. His gruff, unthankful attitude was annoying enough, but getting onto the subject of my cousin's return to Blood Rock had really set Father off. Zeke and I were the same age, and when we were kids, we'd been nearly inseparable. He had an easygoing, happy-go-lucky personality that made him very likable. Truth be told,
The two of us had been known to get into some trouble occasionally, like the time we were supposed to be picking up hay bales at the Yoders, and we'd ended up at the Blood Rock Fairgrounds, watching a tractor pull instead. It would have been a minor infraction for a teenager from the outside, but for us, it was a big deal. We'd both been whipped by our fathers, respectively, and shunned by the community for 3 weeks. No regrets by either of us. The fun we'd had that night had made the punishment worth it. I held in the smile that threatened to spread on my lips. Zeke was my only relative that encouraged me to leave the Amish. He had his own ideas of escape, but that's where we had been different. My high-strung and temperamental ways propelled me straight out the door, without any plans at all. I was impulsive and fancied myself in love with an outsider, and those things were my undoing. Zeke, on the other hand, was very much in control of his destiny. He was a thinker, and he had a plan of action that he carefully and diligently followed through to the end. It was nearly a year after I'd left the community that he'd had enough money saved and connections made with outsiders in Indianapolis. His departure had been so sudden and efficient that it hardly even impacted the congregation. Of course, his folks were devastated, which was expected. A few years after he left, my uncle passed away. Zeke didn't make it back to Blood Rock to say goodbye or console his mother. For all our closeness growing up, Zeke never sought me out either. Whenever I tried to locate him, I'd come up empty every time. My cousin had basically just disappeared into thin air. I never thought I'd see him again. Until today. The jolt of excitement I'd experienced upon learning that Zeke was in town had been quickly doused by my parents' opposite reaction. Their feelings seemed a little harsh after all the years of their nephew's absence. Not wanting to argue with father and ma, I swallowed hard. My relationship with them was already a bit shaky. It was probably best if I just kept my mouth shut, but I couldn't do that. How is Zeke coming back any different than my return into your lives? I dared to ask. Father snorted loudly.
The decision to allow you back into our lives wasn't an easy one. Zeke is a different story altogether.
Why? I persisted. Father snapped his mouth closed and stared out the window. When I looked back at Ma, she too was avoiding my gaze. When my eyes returned to the road, I spotted a black mound on the side of the road. Leaning over the steering wheel, I squinted to get a better look.
Damn it! I appreciate the ride, but I'll not have you cursing in my presence, Ma reprimanded.
A horse is down. There's been an accident, I told her as I grabbed my cell phone and dialed 911. Father rolled down the window and craned his neck to look. My heart pounded inside my chest as I handed the phone to Ma and pulled off into the grass. I've already dialed the emergency number. Talk to the dispatcher and request an ambulance.
Land sakes, we don't even know if anyone is hurt yet, Ma exclaimed.
Better make the call. It doesn't look good.
Father was already out the door, and I quickly followed his lead. The crumpled buggy finally came into view. I passed my father and reached the wreckage first. The horse was already dead, and it was for the best. Both of the poor creature's front legs were broken. If it were still alive, it would be suffering horribly. The way its neck snapped backwards, I guessed it was broken as well. Averting my eyes from its shiny black fur, I heard a soft groan. I dropped to my knees and pushed aside a broken piece of frame. Mary Easter Lapp blinked up at me.
Are you all right?
I offered her my hand and she readily took it, rising to her feet. Other than a gash on her forehead and wobbly legs, she appeared to be okay.
Where's Lester?
She croaked out. My best friend was with his wife? I quickly scanned the buggy debris, not seeing him.
He's down here, Daniel,
Father shouted. Can you stand? I asked. Mary Esther nodded vigorously with tears in her eyes.
Go help him, she urged.
I covered the few meters to the edge of the embankment. It wasn't a steep drop, but there was a stand of trees at the bottom. Lester was moving and slowly climbing back up the hill. I slid past Father and went to meet Lester. Bracing my arm around his shoulder, I supported his weight.
Is Mary Esther hurt?
Lester's eyes were dilated and wide with fright. Good Lord, Lester, you both are very blessed. She's fine and waiting on the road for you, I assured him. Lester heaved a sigh of relief. Bandit, what of my horse? Dropping my head, I gave a little shake. He's gone, my friend. I think it was quick. That's a small mercy, then. Lester blew out another breath. He trembled against my side, and I feared he might lose his balance. Father arrived to brace Lester's other side. He grunted and jutted his head downhill.
There's a pickup truck. You better take a look, Daniel, he advised.
I'd caught a glimpse of the red truck, but was more concerned with my friend and his wife to pay much attention to it. More than likely, the driver was going too fast along the country roads and had struck the buggy because of negligence. It happened all too often in the community. Even with all the warning traffic signs, people wouldn't just slow their vehicles down and pay attention to the roadways. Many Amish and their horses had died because of Englishers' rush to be somewhere. Nowadays, it was even worse with cell phone distractions. But Father was right. At least one person was inside the truck, and they needed help. Do you have him? I asked Father, making sure he could handle Lester the rest of the way up. Father was still a strong man, and he waved me on without hesitation. I left Father and Lester and jogged the rest of the way down. The truck had hit a tree, and the steaming engine curved around its trunk. When I bumped into the truck's bed, I braced my hands on the metal. It was tipped, and I had to slow down to carefully maneuver to the front of the truck. By the looks of the engine, I was afraid what I'd discover when I reached the smashed-in driver's side window. The truck had hit the tree at a very high rate of speed. It was a miracle that Lester and Mary Esther survived the initial impact. Taking a deep breath when I made it to the cab, I leaned forward and looked inside. There was a man in the driver's seat. His shaggy hair had glass chips stuck in it, and there was a smear of blood on the shoulder of his long-sleeved shirt. The seatbelt had kept him from flying through the windshield when the truck hit the tree. I couldn't believe my eyes. The stranger was sitting up and texting on his phone. You okay? I asked tentatively. The man ignored me for a few long seconds before he set the phone down in his lap. When he finally looked up, I drew in a sharp breath and swayed back.
Hello, Daniel. What are the chances we'd meet like this after all these years?
It was my cousin, Zeke Bachman.
4. Serenity.
How often do buggy wrecks happen around here?
Ryan asked. He'd been gazing out the window with rapt interest since we'd entered the settlement. If we're lucky, only a few a year. Usually the accidents are minor with no serious injuries, but sometimes a horse has to be put down, I replied, keeping my eyes straight ahead. A buggy, horseback rider, bobcat equipment, or child on a bike could be around any corner. Driving at a snail's pace had become second nature for me. 5 years ago, before I became sheriff here, there was an accident where a semi-truck struck a buggy, killing a girl and her boyfriend, and crippling a friend of theirs.
Buggies look kind of flimsy to me,
Ryan commented. They are. Definitely no match for a ton of metal. When the flashing lights came into view, Ryan pressed forward. I could feel the tense anticipation oozing off of him. He lived for moments like these. Charging into the unknown was something that Ryan not only did effortlessly, he really enjoyed it. I slowed even more, spotting a half dozen buggies parked in the roadway. Two ambulances were already here, and a single cruiser was parked in the road, stopping traffic.
Considering no one has cell phones, news travels fast around here.
Ryan glanced my way. He controlled his facial features, but I saw the slight raise of the corner of his lip. Oh, yeah. The Amish have an uncanny ability to spread information quickly when the need arises, I agreed. Putting the cruiser into park, I shut off the engine. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw Daniel's Jeep. What's he doing here? I said out loud.
But I was really just talking to myself. Ryan followed my gaze. He used to be Amish, didn't he? Yep, was all I could manage to say. Things might be even more complicated than I'd feared. Ryan exited the car when I did. I scanned the scene, quickly absorbing every detail I could.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.